It is truly an honor emceeing this event tonight and being here with so many fabulous, wonderful people. The Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame recognizes journalists whose impact on Atlanta and the country will definitely be felt forever. Our next induction is credited for helping to give a voice to Atlanta's youth during the fight for civil rights. John Smith Sr. and the founders of the Atlanta Inquirer.
A celebration of John Smith Sr. in March 2016 at City Hall in Atlanta. And it begins with prayer, thanking God for Smith.
A man of real intelligence. We thank you for Brother Smith.
Sunlight and memories fill the reception room. Warriors of the civil rights movement with their children and grandchildren thanking John Smith Sr. for rising up with courage the way he did, when he did. Helping tell the world so long ago when they were all so young about their brand new Atlanta student movement.
When the students couldn't get their message out to the mainstream media, including African American publications, the students got together and formed their own newspaper, and John Smith was there at the beginning.
It was in 1960 when students from the campuses of Atlanta University Center, including Morehouse and Clark and Morris Brown and Spelman, began nonviolent demonstrations in downtown Atlanta, risking their lives, challenging Jim Crow laws and customs. They simply sat peacefully at whites-only public lunch counters, wanting to order coffee and food. And they tried to patronize other white-owned businesses, and police arrested them. But few people were aware of any of that. There was little, if any, news coverage. Not even from the Atlanta Daily World, run by Alexis Scott's family.
My great-uncle, who was publisher at the time, was more of a contemporary of Daddy King and some of the old guard in Atlanta civil rights. And they did not really appreciate the street movement, the direct confrontation movement. They were more in tune with going through the court system.
So in August 1960, they start their own newspaper. The founders are leaders of the Atlanta student movement, including Julian Bond and Lonnie King, along with supporters like Herman Russell and Jesse Hill. And they call their new newspaper the Atlanta Inquirer. And within months, they bring on Morehouse grad, Army veteran, and Atlanta Public School math teacher, John B. Smith, to be editor.
Atlanta Inquirer becomes the voice of a movement. It begins to document on a daily basis this little movement that began in Atlanta with a handful of students, most of them 17, 18, 19 years old.
Smith's bold coverage in the Inquirer began to attract international attention for the student sit-ins, and the city of Atlanta ultimately transitioned to public integration without the riots some cities suffered.
And so people had to be convinced, and they were convinced by the accurate reporting and clear articulation of what their mission and purpose was. And the Atlanta Inquirer was central to that.
But John Smith wasn't finished. He worked to build up what he called the nation's black press in cities across the U.S., helping lead the National Newspaper Publishers Association, all while publishing the Inquirer, now with his son, nonstop since that first issue in 1960, still tackling issues roiling the nation.
Current issues like police brutality, city government issues, everything that impacts the black community is part of the Atlanta Inquirer's table of stories.
So on this late winter day of memories and official thanks from a grateful city, Smith defers to others who speak of him as a quiet warrior. Smartphone cameras raised and recording as Robert Franklin, President Emeritus of Morehouse College, praises Smith and his mighty sword.
Thank you for dipping your pen in acid and writing words that challenge the conscience.
John B. Smith Sr., along with the founders of the Atlanta Inquirer, inductees into the 2016 Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
And please join me in welcoming Atlanta City Councilman Michael Keating.
Thank you and good evening. It is really a pleasure for me to be here today. It is great from the perspective of being an elected official to be here with so much press and not be the point of interest for that press. That's a joke, you can laugh. But I really do feel privileged to be here tonight to bring to the stage Mr. John B. Smith, Sr. I remarked to Michael Russell as we were making our way into the room here this evening, he said he doesn't remember a time not knowing John B. Smith. And I said, you know, I share that same experience. The Inquirer was started before I was born. And he and my father, Lionel Smith, and Carl Holman, and dozens of others that were there at the beginning and the founding of that great paper and institution began it at a time when it was dangerous to do so, when it was unheard of for young people, young entrepreneurs to do so here in the city prior to Atlanta being the city so-called too busy to hate. You know, it was 1960. Atlanta was a segregated place. It was a better southern city than most, and in the atmosphere of the southeastern United States. There's a famous story that remarks that in 1960, all of the Eisenhower highway system signs, when you're moving your way south, pointed toward Birmingham. Today, they now point towards Atlanta. The efforts of John Smith and the Atlanta Inquirer helped make that tremendous change. And it's not just the direction of where you might drive or use as a reference point where you may drive on the highway. It's a reference point for how to advance our civilization, how to advance our culture, how to advance our relations, and how to secure the freedoms of individuals, whether they be African American, female, LGBT, how to make a difference in a community by pursuing the truth and reporting that same truth. The Atlanta Inquirer began as an outgrowth of the students who were involved in the movement that on a weekly basis used to publish a newsletter. Some of you may be familiar with Connie Curry, who was an early ally to the student movement. And my father and Ben Brown and others drafted her, and they jokingly said it's because she had an old mimeograph machine. And so for those of you who may not be old enough to remember a mimeograph machine, it was a hand-cranked copy machine. And so when the students began their movement, the educational leaders around the Atlanta University Center said to them that they needed to publish their manifesto. They did the Appeal for Human Rights, which was published in Atlanta Daily, was published in the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, New York Times, and so forth. But after that publication was made, on the activities that were ongoing for the students, there were many, because they mobilized over 4,000 students in the Atlanta University Center for different efforts, you know, throughout the city and targeted demonstrations around Atlanta. They needed to get the word out to the silent majority in their community. Not only the silent majority in the majority community, I mean the silent majority in the African American community, who was not sold on their movement. As was alluded to in the film by Alexis, the old guard, what became known as the old guard, they believed in a slow progression of negotiation and lawsuits. They didn't believe in direct action. They felt that it was dangerous for activists in Atlanta to engage in that kind of activity. One, because most of the folks in Atlanta who were African American worked for the white establishment in some way, shape, or form, whether it was in individual homes or in businesses, and they felt if they became active in that direct fashion way, they would lose their jobs. They'd have a negative impact, and it would flow back and at them in a very negative way. So they were very suspicious of those types of activities. So it became imperative to get the word out and to continue to educate that silent majority in the African American community about the earnest efforts of the students. And out of that outgrowth, them called home, our read tonight, they established the Atlanta Inquirer. And for more than 56 years, they have pursued the truth, they have reported the truth of authentic Atlanta stories from the African American perspective. And they have not limited their coverage to just the African American community. They've been a crusader for truth on many, many fronts throughout that 56-year history. And John B. Smith, on his own, is a tremendous man and individual. Having known him my entire life, short 50 years, since I was pleased to join the rest of you here in Atlanta, he has been a stalwart in the community, in the West Side community where I grew up, and has always been a mentor, always been a person that had the good advice and to put his hand on my shoulder to give me that kind of fatherly advice, whether it be political or personal. So from a personal sense, I am really honored to be here tonight to bring him to the stage as you all honor him for this tremendous honor that he is more than deserving of.
Right.
He is a tremendous individual, and as was shown in the film, you know, we honor a lot of people in City Hall. We like to do it. We want to highlight folks who are unsung heroes, who are giving back, you know, to Atlanta, who otherwise probably wouldn't be recognized. And so, you know, we have, you know, folks come down to help celebrate some of those honorees. And do you know that John B. Smith Sr. got the largest crowd ever at City Hall in March? Any group of folks that we've ever honored or brought down there to bestow their day. And it was really wholly appropriate. And even though that was a short clip, if you could see the happiness and joy, not only on his face, but on those who came to honor him, because he has touched every facet of the Atlanta community.
Yeah.
This is a tremendous man who, not only as an officer in the national, this is where the 50 years begins to show. It is the National Newspapers Publishers Association, where he's led the effort to bolster African-American newspaper publications around the country. He's been a stalwart advocate for that. He has also done so here by putting pressure on other publications because of the truth that they pursue and the truth that they report. Telling the stories that other folks might be squeamish about, telling the stories that, you know, we don't want to embarrass our friends about, standing up for right, regardless of where the story leads or where the information goes, following the facts to bring that light out of Olympus down to the people like a great Prometheus. This is John B. Smith, Sr. Ladies and gentlemen,
it is indeed an honor to be home with without me. Thank you. You may not have known some of the stories, the highlights of the story that we can hear from 1960. Would you believe a bold magazine by the name of New York Times came to Atlanta to interview the Atlanta Inquirer? And this is what they quoted. a loud voice in the land. We thank them for that honor. You would not know that it was the Atlanta Inquirer that broke the story when Hank Aaron wife was incarcerated for something she would not give the honor. It was on a national level. National newspaper picked up the story about the Payroll Wall. So I don't know which of you do not know. To seek out the truth reported where I feel favored.
That's it.
To my colleagues in the Atlanta University system, I thank you for allowing me to go on this journey with you. I'd like to thank my family at this time. My son and my daughter,
right,
who are here with me. And my daughter, who is my oldest child, passed in April. Another very, very special person. I'd like to thank by the name of Sally J. Warner. You're talking about a friend. That's a real friend. To Herman J. Russell, the late Herman J. Russell.
Right.
To the late Jesse Hill Jr.
Right.
And others who mentored me and gave me the guidance I need to be part of the person I am today. I thank them as well. And I thank so many of you who I call friends, if not before tonight, and yet before.
Yes.
There's a poem that I learned in the ninth grade. As a boy who never dreamed he would meet one president, or two presidents, or three. They said, I am on a piece of work. After I leave your hand, you may never see me again. Therefore, put into me your best, so that I may stand for men and need not be ashamed. Though I may have hurt some of your feelings, know this. I did it out of truth and love.
Right.
Paula, thank you for the phone call to let me know this day was coming. Thank you, Jane. A true, the magnificent spirit of the Lord. Lori, thank you. And Maria. I love you very much, and I will always be appreciative of this evening and this night, that as I go on this journey, I will know the many angels that join me along the trail. But I want all of you to always hold this in your heart. Always. The understanding of the young. Compassionate toward those who are less fortunate than we. If I had 10,000 words, they would not be stretched to you. My gratitude for this evening. But I say to all of you, 10,000 times, thank you, thank you, thank you.
We love you.
One more time for Mr. John. Please stand up, senior. All words for us to take with us tonight. What an amazing evening this has been, and we are not done yet. Before we get to our final induction for the evening, we want to give a special recognition to the team who actually put together these wonderful tribute videos for each one of our inductees. We thank everyone who took the time to actually be interviewed for each video, and we give a special thank you to Richard Crabb with Kettle Creek Media. Richard, are you here? Oh, former photojournalist with me at Channel 11. And Hall of Fame event chair, John Sherrick, with WXIA-TV for writing and producing these amazing videos. I didn't see John. Oh my goodness. And we also appreciate Jay Watson for providing the narration. Our hats off to all of them this evening. That concludes tonight's ceremony. Thank you again to all of our wonderful sponsors on behalf of the Atlanta Press Club. Thank you for attending this Hall of Fame dinner. Have a great evening. Stay safe.
Yes, yeah, table.